Jeremiah chapter 32 in the 16th verse, the Bible says, "Now when I delivered the evidence of the purchase unto Barak, the son of Neriah, I prayed unto the Lord, saying, Ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee. Thou shewest loving kindness unto thousands, and recompense the iniquity of the fathers unto the bosom of their children after them. The great, the mighty God, the Lord of hosts is his name, great in counsel and mighty in work. For thine eyes are open unto all the ways of the sons of men, to give every one according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings, which has set signs and wonders in the land of Egypt, even unto this day, and in Israel, and among other men, and has made thee a name as this day. And has brought forth the people Israel out of the land of Egypt, with signs and wonders, and a strong hand, and with a stretched out arm, and with great terror. Thou hast given them this land, which thou didst swear to their fathers, to give them a land flowing with milk and honey." I'd like to preach this evening, the Lord being my helper, on the thought, the mighty God of the Bible. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your watch care. We praise you and lift you up tonight that you are the God that this book claims you to be, and we praise you for that. Lord, we praise you and honor you for your goodness and your watch care in our lives. We see that how you've safely brought us along this way for many, many years, and we give you praise for that tonight. Lift you up in that. Lord, we pray for the saved here tonight that you would stir us up and that we'd be mindful of how great and how wonderful and how marvelous it is of the things that you do. Lord, we pray for the lost that be with us that you might touch them tonight, that you would reveal yourself and your mightiness and your power to save unto them, and we'd be faithful to give you the praise for it, for it's in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Now, we'll be preaching on the character of God that I love best tonight, and that's how mighty and how great and how wonderful and how marvelous he really is. You know, if anything about the teaching of the sovereignty of God is this, is that he's great and wonderful. Amen. You know, I don't quite understand election and predestination. I just know that it's so. But you know what thrills my heart about that teaching more than anything else? It shows that God is the great one, and we are down here. And without his help, without his intervention, there's nothing that can be done. That's a great God. A God that caused the sun to come up this morning, and he's going to cause it to set here in a few minutes. That's the God of the Bible. And we'll see that. You know what? We think about it. I almost get duped into believing what this world believes. But you know why the sun rises? Because God wants it to rise. Amen. And you know what? If he doesn't want it to rise, it don't. You say, well, that's foolish. Well, it happened in Egypt, did it not? It was a blackness that could be felt. That's the God of the Bible. And you know, the larger danger than Arminian doctrine, and it is a horrible danger to duke someone into believing they're saved when they're lost, but the big danger of that doctrine is this: it minimizes God to something nothing more than that we keep on a string. And so, our God's a great God, and he needs to be praised this evening. He needs to be lifted up. He needs to be glorified by his people, and that is our job. Verse 15 says, "For thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses and fields and vineyards shall be possessed again in this land." He was promising them that they would repossess the land in the days following Jeremiah. Verse 16, "Now when I had delivered the evidence of the purchase..." Now, in your extra time for the rest of the week, you can look at the evidence of the purchase. But listen, they were already going under Babylonian captivity. They were already being captured. They were already losing their lands. And in the midst of this upheaval, God tells a man, you go buy some land and you present the deed to the leaders. And that's what they did, you know, because what that really was an evidence of the promise God had given Israel. It will be your land and you will possess it. And so he went and bought him this land, and in the midst when everything else was being lost, he presented the deed, and it was a testimony what God had done in a time when otherwise it wouldn't have happened. You know what? Every one of us, if we begin to to go and look back down through the years of our life, we have an evident token of the goodness of God. Whether it's health or whether it's just being preserved. If you look back over your life, you think time and time and time again where you should have checked out of this place, but God preserved you. You know, He has that ability.
Yeah.
He's good. He's a marvelous God. He's wonderful in all that He does. And so in this time of otherwise complete falling away of the nation, we find a man carrying a deed down. And just like we would go to the courthouse and record a deed, going down and saying, this is my land. This is the place that God's given me in a day of complete turmoil and upheaval. You know what that says to me? That in this day which we live of turmoil and upheaval, we still have a place to be. We still have a God that's preserving. You know, things are probably going to get worse. I tell you what, it's going to become illegal one day for us to meet like this. You say, well, I won't ever live to see that. Well, you probably will. The oldest one in here probably lived to see it. Because we live in a nation of God haters. We really do. Now, they don't hate the God of this world. And everybody says, well, the God of this world is money. I don't believe that. The God of this world is religion. And by that, I don't mean not knowing the great God Jehovah. I mean religion in the fact that you do things and you go. Long as you don't upset the apple cart, listen, they're not upset with you, but you're going to say, hey, listen, sodomy is a sin according to the Word of God, and it won't be done in this place. When you get down to that, listen, you're going to have some problems. You're going to have some difficulty. And so we see in this day of upheaval, it's just like the days that they lived, and God gave him a statement, a testimony in that day. Now, as he's leaving, he knows God has done a wonderful thing. In verse 17, he says, ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made heaven, the earth, by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee. Now, what a wonderful thing. And you think you probably have never done this, and I don't know that I have either. But you know what? God knows that He made the earth. He knows it all. He knows everything. But here we find this man saying, thou that has made the earth, ah, oh, you made it all. All power is... You know what? He was honoring Him. God didn't need to know that, but He needed to be praised for it. He needed to be lifted up. You know why we have breath of life right now? Because of the goodness of God. That's why we have breath of life. That's why we sit in the place that we do. And instead of getting happy and getting glad, we get the mother grudge, oh, woe is me, and boo-hoo, and I'm tired, and I can't do this, and I can't do that. Well, find something to praise God for. Because He's worthy, and He's to be lifted up by His people.
Amen.
Because listen, this world's not going to do it. You know what this world's going to be praising, how this world praises God? When one day they finally stand in judgment. That's how they'll praise God. When He says, depart from me, you work of iniquity, because I never knew you. That's when they'll praise God. So we ought to praise Him now, have we not?
Amen.
Should we not lift Him up and give Him due benevolence for what He does for us? Verse 18, the writer says, Thou shewest loving kindness unto thousands. Now, I want you to see this because it always thrills my heart every time that this can be pointed out. As much as we would like to think so because we're flesh, God doesn't grant loving kindness to everybody. It says to thousands, right? That's a specific number, is it not? We don't know. So, you know what? You know why you're here? Because of His loving kindness. If you're saved tonight, you know why you're saved? Because of His loving kindness. If He's placed you in one of His churches, you know why it is? Because of His loving kindness. If you're able to throw the covers back in the morning and crawl out of bed, you know why? It's because of His loving kindness. Plus nothing, minus nothing. Listen, the writer here knew that. He understood that. And it would do us well this evening if we would grant the ability and power that our God possesses and give him due praise for what he should be praised for. I want you to see at the end of 17, I missed this, that the writer had gotten this idea. There's nothing too hard for me. Sometimes we have to go through some pretty tight places to learn that principle. Now, we believe God's sovereign, do we not?
Yeah.
That means there's no accidents, right? January the 3rd, 1989. That was an accident.
Right?
It showed me that God was sovereign. 2008, about March, Dr. Singh looked at me and Donna and goes, I don't have anything left to offer you except surgery. That wasn't no accident, was it? My God doesn't make accidents. But through different instances like this, I have learned this, my God can be depended on.
Yeah.
He can be relied on. And when everything else is down and out and seemingly nothing left to do, you know what? When the Bible says, cast all your cares upon the Lord. Cast all your doubts, all your insecurities, everything that you're unsure about, cast them on the person of the Lord Jesus Christ and all will be well. You know what? I've got a solution for stress tonight, and that solution is the person of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And if you don't understand that, you probably don't know Him like I do. And sometimes you need a few of those little difficult spots to begin to understand the character of God. Verse 18, thou shewest loving kindness unto thousand, recompensest the iniquity of the fathers into the bosom of their children after them. Now, that middle part of that verse, it's sometimes hard to praise the Lord for certain things, but I want you to see that it says in the middle there that the sins and the character of the father would be recompensed or paid for in their children. That's what a recompense is. It's a pay. You know what? That would make us want to walk on the eggshells. I'm looking at my son and my daughter and my granddaughter thinking, you know what? What I do impacts them.
Yeah.
And I need to be careful about that. That's the God of the Bible. And if you don't believe that, you look at familial sin. And I'll give you an example. One thing that I've seen that follows family lines is alcohol. And you know what? They even think they've identified the alcoholic gene. And you know what that really is? That's just proving the Bible that the recompense will come back. So you know what? That says to me, my children don't need to see me drinking. My children don't need to see me smoking, because if the familial sin is there. And so we see even in that, we have a God that we can praise, because it comes out just like He says. The last part of that verse 18, the great and mighty God, the Lord of hosts, is His name. Great in counsel. You know what a council is, don't you? That's when you go up, and I've done this a lot over the years, and say, Junior, I'm not sure what to do. And have you thought about this? Have you thought about that? And your very best friend and your closest confidant, sometimes you just don't, they don't have no advice to you either, but I have a counselor that I can go to and lay all my problems out before Him, and He will give me wise counsel every time. He will show me what to do. He'll show me where to go. He'll show me exactly what needs to be done. That's a wise counselor, a close and mighty friend. That is the God that we serve. We ought to be able to praise Him. You know what? He's never done one thing wrong. He's never came on the scene late. He's never been. He's never came in at the wrong time. He's God.
Yeah.
And we want to be able to praise Him for it. You know what? When we get all stressed out, and man, the devil likes to put us in a bad situation. You know what? He wanted to get Job down in the gutter. You know, it wasn't about taking Job's riches. It wasn't about taking Job's children. It was to take his testimony. Remember what he said? Yeah, have you not placed a hedge about him? You remove all that and curse God to his face. Mm. But you know what? He didn't. And in fact, you remember what God said. Have you considered my servant Job? There's none like him in the earth. See, he already had that testimony. And sometimes we just have to go through those things so people will know about our God. He's a great, mighty God. He's one to be lifted up. He's one to be glorified. He's one to be amplified. Verse 19, great in counsel and mighty in work. Now we're going to talk a little bit about his wonderful works in a minute. But I will tell you this, he works. When there's nothing left to be done, God works. Now, the sad truth is two ways. Number one, sometimes that's our last alternative. Well, I've done everything else. Let me pray about it. That's foolish.
Yeah.
We should be praying first.
All right.
And then sometimes he exhausts all the other possibilities so that he can be exalted. He might let you try one thing and it don't work out, and you try something else and that don't work out, and then that way he's exhausted. You've done everything you can think of, and then God comes in and does a great and wonderful thing. That's the God that we serve. That's the God of the Bible. He's not trying to accomplish something, but rather he does everything, the Bible says, after the counsel of his own will. Great in counsel, mighty in works, for thine eyes are open upon all the ways of the sons of men. Now, if you underline in your Bible, underline that one. His eyes are open all the way to the sons of who? Men. Remember, there were two races of people, the sons of God and the sons of men, right? There was the line that came out of Seth, and there was the line that came out of Cain, right? See, we don't know what the enemy's up to, but God does. His eyes on him. He knows exactly what's going on. He knows when the attack's coming. He knows when it's coming for. He'll prepare you. See, he has that understanding. He has that knowledge that is beyond our comprehension. And then sometimes we waver at following his advice. We waver at following his direction. No, no. He should come first. He should get the great glory and honor for exactly who he is. Notice verse 20, which has set signs and wonders in the land of Egypt. Now, you know, those signs and wonders are still being testified of today. All of you know that the debris from the Red Sea crossing was only found about 20 years ago. And before that, they denied it, said it wasn't true, that the Egyptians were never even in that area. But when the Red Sea got almost dried up in a drought about 20 years ago, they began to find pieces of the carriages and the wheels and their headgear. You know what? It's still being proved today. Still being testified. You know what? those movies about the Great Sea, the Red Sea crossing, I don't know. You know what? That is kicking up dust on the way across there. It wasn't mud. You know that little thing over there in water about this deep. You know what? The Bible says they crossed dry shod.
Yeah.
Kicking up dust on the way to the promised land. See, that's the God of the Bible. That's the one we serve. That's the one we ought to give praise and glory and honor to tonight, because he is able. He's done this for us. Now, if you will, go with me back to the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 1, in the very first verse. In the beginning, God. You know, that's pretty simplistic, isn't it? But it is exactly what it says. God predated everything else. In the beginning, God already was. In the beginning, God was already present. In the beginning, God. And you know what? We ought to praise Him for that. We ought to lift Him up. He is the Creator. Everything is orderly and divine after the counsel of His own will. That's the God of the Bible. He is never, ever, ever not being. He's God. You know what? Even in all three persons, He's always been. The Son's always been, the Father's always been, and the Holy Ghost has always been. That's the God of the Bible. Always existing, ever and always. You know what? That amount of being, we don't even grasp because we have to be led by time. In the beginning, God created heaven and the earth was without form and void, and darkness upon the face of the deep. Now, the Bible says He moved across the waters. You know what? We really don't understand the type of darkness that was present. But listen, long when I think about my lost condition before the Lord saved me, that's something like the darkness that was here before God came on the scene. And if He had never moved on me, I'd be just as hopeless as this earth was without Him. See, that gets back down to the condition of man, doesn't it? Darkness. That's what we're in. You know, sometimes if we're not real careful, we get a little frustrated with lost people and get a little mad. But just remember this, there go I, but the grace of God.
Yeah.
And then that way maybe you can pray for him. Because you know what? It wasn't anything of your merit that he moved across you either. It was just because of His own mercy and grace and His goodness.
Right, amen.
That's why He did it. And so when we think about this formless blank of nothing, that's me and that's you, and that's the way the world was before God began to move. Verse 3, and God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness He called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. Now, what a wonderful thing to know that our powerful, mighty God is over all of it.
Yeah.
That's why, you know, the sun will come up tomorrow if God wills it to be. And you know what? Just as surely as that, and we never look at the flip side, if He don't will it to be, it won't. There'll be no day to it. You say, well, that's impossible. What wasn't here? Looks like from there, there was always darkness. There was never day, right? And so we see then what an awesome, marvelous, wonderful God we serve, that He is over everything, over all, and everything is under Him. Look with me in Genesis 17. Genesis 17. Genesis 17, verse 17. Bible says, and Abraham fell upon his face and laughed, and said in his heart, shall a child be born unto him that is 100 years old? And shall Sarah that is 90 years old bear? Now, I want you to see, here we find that God has revealed to Abraham the plan of God. Now, I want you to see, before the revealing of the full plan of God, that Abraham was obedient. When he was still Abram, he called him out of Ur of the Chaldees and said, I want you to come out and I'm going to make a strong nation out of you. And at 75, he left the only place that he really ever knew, and he left out of there. Now, the problem is this. He brought Lot with him, and Lot had no business there. He had no portion of the promise. It did not belong to him. In other words, you know what? Sometimes you better just leave people. Now, was Lot an elect? I have to believe he was, because the Bible said he had delivered just Lot. But I do not believe he was part of God's plan. And the reason I don't is because God eliminated him before he fulfilled his plan. Right? And then after they got there and they got rid of the Lot, then he rose up and said, "Okay, I'll get me a son through the bondwoman." God said, no, that's not my plan either. And he shot that in the hill. And they still dealing with Ishmaelites all over there today. When you see one of the cow heads come through, you can say, "Hey, that's a descendant of Ishmael," because that's who he is. And they're still dealing with that tragedy even today. And you know what? I feel like they will as long as the earth exists. I don't think there's no solution to it. And then finally he says, "Okay, got rid of Ishmael, got rid of Lot. Now it's time to do business my way." And he gave him God's plan. And what did he do? He laughed at it. You know, often we do the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, I will say this. Success is not measured in man's components. If you measure success the way man does, you'll be very soon discouraged. I mean, look about the building. Why is there 10 of us here? 12, maybe 15? 12. That looks, to most people, that would look stupid. But don't measure success in that way. See, God said, "I'm going to make out of you a great nation. You and Sarah will have a great day." That was his plan. And why not just go with it? And you know the rest. And certainly they did that. And then after he got through with his belly laugh, God, the Godhead comes down in all three persons and meets with Abraham. And they have a meal together. And they reveal further of God's plan. And this time Sarah hears it. And she goes to laughing at him. Now, can you imagine laughing at the Godhead? Well, every time you reject that book, that's what you're doing.
Yeah.
Every time that you don't want to honor God with your tithes and offering, you're laughing at that book. Ladies, every time you want to take the upper hand from your husband, you're laughing at that book. Right? Every time that We reject a revealed truth, we're laughing at that book. So don't get too far down on Sarah, because we all do it. And so we see then that God revealed himself and how divine he was, and then these old people bore a child naturally. Against every odd, against anything that we can even think of, they had a child just like your children were born at 190. He was 100, she was 90. And really, if you follow this out, actually they're probably 101 and 91. Because this was a year before before Isaac arrived. So really, they're probably about 101 and 91. Now, I've known lots of people that age. I really have over the years. But I never, ever, ever saw one that I thought was able to have a child. And you know why? Because it's against faith. You know why that child came? It came because of faith. It's because Abraham and Sarah believed it.
Amen.
That's why it happened. Somewhere they quit laughing and started believing God. And you know what? He accomplished it. They had a son, and he was the chosen son. And out of him came the great nation that he was promised. See, that's the God that we serve. Yes, they had a child. Yes, it was a natural child. Yes, it was born just like all babies have always been born, except the Christ child himself. That's what happened. That's what our God can do. Look with me in 2 Kings chapter number 2. 2 Kings chapter number 2. Second Kings chapter number 2, verse 14. The Bible says, "And he," meaning Elisha, "and he took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him and smote the waters and said, 'Where is the God of Elijah?' And when he also had smitten the waters, they parted hither and thither, and Elisha went over." Now, I tell you what, that's hard for us to see sometimes. That's hard for us to contemplate. Now, the Jordan River, the way I understand it, it's very rough waters. It's not like the Cumberland. The Cumberland down here has been kind of dug out on the inside to the point that there's not a lot of dips in it and stuff like that. It's just a very smooth flowing river. I have trouble imagining coming, and remember, we serve an ever-changing God. So should he want it to happen, you know what? Our God could split the Cumberland River. Right? His character doesn't change, does it not?
Yeah.
But I'll guarantee you, including myself, I'm lumping me with you guys. Man, it'd be hard for me to believe to see the Cumberland River split open. I've lived on that river all my life. I've never seen it part. Have you? Easy able? Well, he took it in belief. He took the mantle, he slapped the river, and it opened up. What if he never slapped it? See, he believed that God was able. That's a mighty God. Now, the way I understand about the Jordan River, it's a very swift, hard-running river. It's not like the Cumberland. It's not smooth. It's a very swift, constantly moving, constantly churning. And also makes me think of this. You remember when they were moving out for the first time under the direction of Joshua? What were the priests asked to do? To step out into Jordan. And that's something that we can just smooth right over and keep reading, right? Well, when you think about stepping out in a river that got to take you away by its current, that takes faith, does it not? Because if you've ever been in fast-moving water, and I have, I've seen a creek at Carlisle literally up to the highway at 49. And it takes some faith to step off in that, wouldn't it? But they did. And the reason Elisha picked it up and hid it is because he had seen the example that Elijah left with. See, he'd just been through there before. He just walked through it and he knew God was able. You know, that means that we can convey that kind of faith to the young people behind us if they see it. Now, if they don't ever see it, then they won't ever learn from you. And so we see then that the very same God that caused the river to stand up like two walls on each side of Elijah and Elisha as they marched across through there, that very same God is the God that I tell you of tonight, the God that saves even the most corrupt sinner, the God that is real, that manifests himself to his people even today, that very same God is the one to be worshipped and honored and praised and lifted up and given a great, great name above every name. And listen, that's what we are to do. That's what we are to do. Need never be embarrassed about the God of the Bible. I'll say this, be very careful when you begin to try to figurize the Bible. In other words, oh, it's figurative there. Now the problem is this, what I've seen is, okay, then where are you going to draw the line? If that's figurative, then what about this? And that is where people go with that. You know what I believe? I believe the Bible is literally what it says it is. Unless it says, and he spoke unto them in a parable. Then I can say, yeah, that's a parable. Otherwise, I have to believe it's exactly what it says it is, right? I may not understand it, I may not get it completely, but I do have to believe that's exactly what it is what it says it is. 2 Kings chapter number 20. 2 Kings 20. Verse 11. 2 Kings 20 and verse 11. And Isaiah the prophet cried unto the Lord, and he brought the shadow 10 degrees backward on which it had gone down in the dial of Ahaz. Now, getting back to who controls the times. See, Elijah was preaching and Ahaz wasn't believing. And so, God just said, okay, I'll show you something. He moved it back 10 degrees. Now, that is about, some people say about a half hour. Some people say 15 minutes. I'm not sure about that. But I do know this. that right now, if God wanted to move her back to the east again a little ways, he's able. He can get the job done. I fully believe that time is just in his hands. And he does what seems good to himself. And we've got so used to counting days and numbering things that we think it's going to always just be that way. But I'll give you this. Except those days be shortened, there should be no man saved. And listen, that's talking about this stuff right here. It wasn't talking about salvation of men, eternal salvation. It was talking about us being preserved from the last days. See, our God's able. I'll give you one better than that. Have you ever seen, like in the modern day, you just don't have time to do everything you used to do? I find myself that. Well, I come to this conclusion. The days are short. They are short. Now, I know on your 24-hour thing, you're like, oh, it's always been 24 hours. The days are short. And that's under the hand of a mighty God of heaven. See, he's a great and marvelous God. And everything is under the counsel of his own will. He does what seems good for himself. So time itself is under the mighty hand and the mighty use of God to do whatever ever that he wants to. Gospel of Matthew chapter 28. And we could go on and on and on all night about the greatness of the God of the Bible. But I want to leave you with this. Matthew 28 in the very first verse. Now, as we get into this, I want you to know the Lord Jesus said, I must rise, I must die, but I'll live again. You know, how quickly did the apostles forget that? How quickly did they get the honey-grummies? You know, that woe is me is plagued Baptist from day one. And we find it here. They's discouraged, they's ready to quit. Lord Jesus had laid in the grave 3 days, 3 nights. The Sanhedrin was guarding the grave, or the Romans were guarding the grave. So we find in chapter 28, in the very first verse, the Bible says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and set upon it. And his countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said to the women, fear not ye, for I know ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. You know what a marvelous, wonderful thing that is. Now, my own self, I think he was in the belly of the earth for 3 days and 3 nights, and he fulfilled that scripture. I don't think he was in the grave. Because see, our graves are just surface scratches. I believe it was in Abraham's bosom, preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to people like Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Noah, Seth. They were learning about the goodness of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was fixing to lead captivity captive out of that place. Mm-hmm. Isn't it a marvelous, wonderful God? You know, our God never needs help with nothing. Lazarus, come forth. May I say to thee, arise. He only knows help. That's the God of the Bible. That is the God that we serve every day. He's powerful and mighty. So why do we get so discouraged and why do we get so down and out? Well, I can tell you why. We take our eyes off Jesus. If we stay in focus with him, we're fine. But when the lightning begins to roll and the winds begin to rise, we very easily, just like Peter, go, oh me, the storm's coming! Well, I know the God is storm. He's good. Always, everything under his own power. We should be able to give him praise for it. All right.